And for the recording too.
Hello, I...
Yeah.
Oh, God, I hate my voice.
Yeah.
I couldn't help notice, but look at the parallels you have with the anti-identitarian left. For example, I go on a board called Lefty Poll. It's full of anti-identitarians who criticise both the identity politics of the right, especially those on poll, and which is on the left, such as those you might find on Tumblr. And I was thinking, the whole thing about class not being a struggle, why do people make these things identities when sometimes they can be concrete facts, such as in the Marxist view or even in the Lacanian view? Why do they make them identities?
Give me an example. I'm sorry. So sincerely, I don't get clearly what are you aiming at. Are you speaking now, which identity are you mentioning? Sexual identity or more class identity?
Well, the process of creating the identities... For example, I saw a funny meme where there was someone on Twitter saying, explaining, and defining it as when a rich person explains something to a poor person, and followed by a funny caption saying, class war's over, guys. Why are things turned into identities? And why do we get this identitarian and thus the moralistic sentiment that comes out of this identity politics?
Okay, I will now ask you a rough question because I'm not sure, like, where do you stand here?
I'm anti-identitarian, a very staunch Marxist.
Perfect, then we agree, because you know what's for me the basic problem? Identity politics is for me the politics of coexistence. The goal is not to destroy the other, but can't we all live together with our identities recognized? And of course, at a certain level, this holds. But not at the basic class level. There, I'm sorry, class struggle does not mean we should get over it and have some identity politics where proletarians can be fully proletarian and bourgeois fully bourgeois and whatever. No, it's a totally different type of antagonism. It's a radical antagonism. And my problem with identity politics is that this type of antagonism disappears or is even translated into antagonism. For example, in United States, I noticed how class issues tend to be retranslated into identity issues. For example, the usual, when they speak about Mexicans, if you listen to many academic texts, it's almost as if it's not economic struggle, but what appears as economic struggle is our intolerance of the Mexicans. And then you even go a step further into some pseudo-Freudianism and says, we project our fears onto Mexicans. But what are these fears? We should look deeper into ourselves and locate it and so on and so on. So again, my reproach against identity politics is first, I'm an old-fashioned universalist. I think a priori, that's my sensitivity with that LGBT point, we don't want to be hurt. Well, sometimes you have to be hurt. For example, I'm not changing the topic. Another point I wanted to develop. One way I was attacked when I was in Ramallah, I think I did a very proper anti-Muslim point. I said, we should attack, of course, the honor killings and so on. But I just listed a series of other examples from Canada to Mexico to my own country, where also horrible things are happening to women, to minorities, no? And I just say that we have to fare and locate all these horrors. And you know what reply I got? A pretty horrifying reply for me. It was that while apparently I was criticizing violence against women, children, and so on, by talking about it, I was reproducing it verbally. I totally oppose it, you know, for what reason? It's an old humanist saying by Edward Bond. It's a little bit too naive, but I agree with it. He said somewhere that if you don't want to confront Hiroshima in theater openly, you will probably confront it in reality again. That is to say, I think that things like rape and horrors and torture, whatever, we have to confront them in a brutal way. We must be hurt. These are horrible things. Otherwise, we will follow that way to which I often refer, yes, immediately, mockingly. You know, now that, as we learn from Americans, torture is called enhanced interrogation technique. So I ironically proposed once, why don't we call rape enhanced seduction technique or whatever, you know, like all the horror disappears. No, you must, that's why I'm totally opposed. Of course, within certain limits, I know what means to be really terrifying and so on, but hurt, but to this trigger warning system now in America. I mean, sorry, university is not an isolated place where you are safe. University should precisely expose us to the brutality of life. Of course, not at the level of being really raped, but to confront the horror. Only this works. And that's, for me, the fear of all these trigger warnings. People must not feel safe. People must be safe. And the worst thing is that to make you feel safe where you are not really safe. So, you see, my problem with identity politics is that it simply, for example, the moment with LGBT, the moment I just said that, I'm not saying this devalues LGBT, but the fact that all the big business is emphatically supporting it. It says something. We should at least ask, is then this a totally neutral field? Can we somehow combine LGBT with other struggles? How? I was instantly attacked for class essentialism. Class in this identity politics, class essentialism is a label which you get if you just mention class in any way. I know when they say there are multiple struggles, class, race, sex, class never really occurs there. And things get especially problematic, as it often happens, when the very progressive identity politics gets caught into, gets a very weird class connotation. How often I encountered in the United States that beneath the critique of male chauvinism and so on, anti-feminism, it was really upper middle class white academics silently targeting allegedly primitive Mexican workers who don't read their... Well, you know, I simply think, of course, it's not the simple old bourgeois proletariat, but something that we should still call class struggle antagonism is going on, getting stronger and stronger. And my source would be here like somebody whom you really cannot accuse to be a leftist, Peter Sloterdijk. He wrote a book on, I quote it often, on capitalism as a cupola, where he in a wonderful develops how this logic Hollywood, you know, if you are disoriented, look at the good Hollywood blockbuster. No? Although they're very problematic films, but like Hunger Games, Elysium, we are moving towards this. 20% people live in a cupola, protected, majority is out, and so on. And this tension, I reject to claim that this basic tension is simply one on at the same level with others. This is the radical tension that still defines us. But I talk too much. There was the gentleman there.